course, or at least a mini course, that we have to, of course, add a field trip component to make sure that we really rounded it out. So we're not going to do that. What we're going to do is actually take something of a whirlwind tour through some basic fundamentals of religious Zionist thought as it evolved from the 20th into the 21st century. And we're going to see the political consequences of some of the ideas that were articulated by some of the great thinkers. That, I think, is really the organizing idea. I think if we want to have one lesson, one thing that we can walk away from this classroom, and I'll tell it to you, right at the beginning, it's that when Jews have their own country, and they're making Jewish laws, and they have to make big decisions about issues that pertain to Jewish emotions, or Jewish values, or Jewish principles, no idea is just an idea. No thought, no book is just a thought or a book. Everything, every idea, every Dvar Torah, every halachic ruling has very concrete political consequences. I can tell you this, I saw this firsthand. When I was studying in yeshiva in Israel, I studied in a yeshiva called Kerem Yavne, which was the first of the Hesder yeshivot. And during my first year studying in yeshiva, one of the alumni of our yeshiva assassinated the prime minister of the state of Israel. And to describe to you what it was like being in the yeshiva at that time, you know, words defy it. But I'll just tell you one thing that at the time really struck us all as very bizarre, and we really didn't understand it. But over the years, I've grown to understand it with a lot more clarity. The former teacher of Yigal Amir was a little old rabbi, the oldest rabbi in the yeshiva. His name was Rav David Kav. And Rav David Kav was known for being the gentlest, most modest soul in the yeshiva. He was, still is, very short, very soft-spoken, and old. And he had grown up in Yerushalayim in the days and before the State of Israel and in the early days of the State of Israel. And if there's one thing you would never, ever associate with this rabbi, it is in any way encouraging anyone to commit an act of violence of any sort against anyone else, or even an act of not being nice to anyone else. You would never, ever associate that with this rabbi if you knew him and his disposition. Nevertheless, after the assassination of Rabin, he was brought down to be interrogated by the Shin Bet. And he came back to yeshiva, and we all went out to greet him, and we all went into his house. He lived in a little cottage on the campus of the yeshiva, and as many guys as possible, you know, Kerem Yavne is a decent-sized yeshiva, so as many of us as possible packed into his cottage, and he described to us what it was like being interrogated by the Shabak, by the Israeli Secret Service. And they asked him, what do you teach? And he said, I teach Talmud. They said, what age are your students? He said, at 18, 19 years old. And they asked him, teach us a lesson in the Talmud. What do you mean? He said, what was the most recent lecture that you gave, the most recent shiur that you gave in Gemara? We were learning Masechet Ketubot that year. And he said, well, I gave a shiur, a particular topic. And they said, give us the shiur. Teach it to us. And he proceeded to give them a shiur about one of the real technical points of the halachot of marriage and relationships between men and women, and that was it. When he was done, they said, that's what you teach? He said, yeah, that's what I teach. Said, you give a class like that to 19-year-old boys? He said, I was 16 when I first learned this topic under discussion. And that was the end of that component of his interrogation. At the time, we were all a little mind-boggled. Why would they possibly ask this little old, modest, quiet rabbi if we thought that he encourages violence, and if what we learned in the yeshiva, if we sat around all day learning the halachot of, the Israeli government and what happens if you don't like them or disabuse them, then okay, I would understand fully well why you would ask him to teach a model lesson. But we study Talmud, we study abstract ideas, we analyze things and conceptualize. Why would you possibly ask this rabbi to give you a shiur on the discussion of a man and a woman and their first night of marriage in what way is this relevant to the Rabin assassination? It took me a few years to figure this out. But if we can walk away from anything else from today's discussion, it's that if you are in Israel, and if you're talking to people who take Judaism and Jewish law and Jewish philosophy seriously, every idea has a consequence, and a very concrete and often a very political consequence. That's our introduction to what we're going to learn today. And what I want to do is walk through some of the major trends, some of the major ideas when it comes to religious Zionism. Not general Zionism, which unfortunately we don't have time to get into today, and not just, you know, caring about Israel or advocating for Israel, but what did the rabbis who were articulating what they saw as the religious significance of the state of Israel, what did they believe about the state of Israel? And here's the big question, how did those ideas impact their students and their followers and the people who claim to speak in their name? So what we're going to see is some fascinating developments. Now, any discussion of religious Zionism, especially religious Zionism in Israel, must begin with Rav Kook. And I gave you about four pages of sources from Rav Kook, and we're not going to, like I said, we're not going to look at all of them. I just want to look at a few ideas from Rav Kook, and I want to see, what did Rav Kook, we're talking about Rabbi Abraham Yitzchak HaKohen Kook. Rav Kook, for those of you who probably already know, but just to review, Rav Kook was born in 1865 in Latvia. He died in 1935 in Jerusalem. By the time he died in 1935, he had become the chief rabbi of the Jewish community in Mandate Palestine, in Eretz Israel. He had been the chief rabbi of Yerushalayim. He was the leading intellectual and spiritual spokesperson for religious Zionism. And since Rav Kook's lifetime, beginning in his own lifetime, but continuing to today, there is no serious religious Zionist yeshiva or student or a person who wants to endeavor to study religious Zionism in Israel that can do so without really, really getting into the writings of Rav Kook. So I want to look at a sampling from Rav Kook's very vast corpus of written literature to see what did Rav Kook teach us about Israel, and what did he teach about the land of Israel, and specifically the state of Israel. And what I want to tell you is that for Rav Kook, those two ideas have to go hand in hand. The first thing that you have on page one, we're only going to actually look at the first paragraph on page one, and even that, we're only going to look at a couple of lines. And when I read it to you, when we read it together, you're going to see why we're not reading the whole thing. Okay? This is the opening section of the book called Orot. Orot was a book edited by Rav Kook's son, Rav Tzvi Yehuda, who we're going to look at very soon, containing Rav Kook's teachings about Israel and the development of Jewish nationalism in Israel. But it starts off not talking about the state of Israel or the political entity that was developing, but it starts off talking about the land of Israel. Rav Kook says this, Eretz Yisrael einena davar chitzoni. The land of Israel is not an external thing. Kinyan chitzoni la'uma, some external property of the nation. Rak b'tor emtza'i l'matara shel. I'm just going to read it through and I'll let you bask in this prose because it's beautiful. Rak b'tor emtza'i l'matara shel hitagdut haklalit b'achzakat kiyuma hachomri o afilu haruchani. Eretz Yisrael hi chativa atzmutit kishura v'kesher chayim im ha'uma. Chavuka v'skulot mimiyot mitziyuta. To basically render Rav Kook's beautiful Hebrew prose into some very vulgar English. What Rav Kook is basically saying is this. What is the relationship between the Jews and the land of Israel? We don't just go to the land of Israel, says Rav Kook, because we need to escape from anti-Semitism. That was, of course, the predominant Zionist theory in Rav Kook's day. Nor do we go to the land of Israel because we want a place where all the Jews could get together and learn Torah, and Israel's the best place. That was a more Haredi approach, also very prevalent during Rav Kook's day. None of that is true about the relationship between the Jews and Israel, says Rav Kook. Instead, Rav Kook says, Eretz Yisrael is a component of our very identity as Jewish people. He says, Kshura b'kesher chayim ha'uma. It is tied to us with the bonds of life. Chavuka b'skulot pnimiyot imitziyuta. It's embraced with the most inner secrets of our existence. Again, this beautiful, kind of mysterious, kind of difficult prose to unpack. But what Rav Kook is essentially saying is, there is no Jewish people that really flourishes and functions as a people without Eretz Israel, without being in the land of Israel. And again, can't really do it now, but if you look at the remainder of the paragraphs that I photocopied and stuck onto that sheet, you'll see that that's essentially what he's saying. Jewishness is not fully realized unless you're in Israel. And by extension, says Rav Kook, anything that a Jew does in Israel to contribute to progress, scientific progress, economic progress, cultural progress, anything that a Jew does in Israel, says Rav Kook, is by definition Jewish. Again, these are very difficult concepts for us to unpack, but that's where Rav Kook begins. Rav Kook begins with the idea that you can't be fully Jewish without being in Israel, and our connection to Israel is not a political connection, it's not an emotional connection, it's a very deep and intrinsic spiritual bond that makes the Jews connected to the land of Israel, such that everything that we do in Israel is Jewish, and nothing that we do outside of Israel is Jewish. That's not a statement about anything political in any way. That's a mystical statement about the value of the land of Israel. But what I want to show you now, and really beginning from that point, beginning from the assumption that Israel is an intrinsic component of being Jewish, and that anything that goes on in Israel is very deeply and spiritually Jewish, now we can start talking about Rav Kook's reaction to the events of his day. What do I mean? Rav Kook came to Israel from Europe around the same time, and basically during the wave of immigration to Israel that we call the Second Aliyah. The Second Aliyah, for those of you who know a little bit about the history of modern Israel, was really like the big paradigm-shifting influx of Jews into Eretz Israel. And it completely changed the face of Israel. Until the Second Aliyah, the overwhelming majority of the Jews living in Israel were religious. Some were Ashkenazim, some were Sephardim, some were Hasidim, some were Mizrahim, but overwhelmingly they were religious. At the very least, they were very, very traditional. A lot of them, you know, a small group had tried to found some Jewish political entity in Israel. Those are the people who came on the first Aliyah, but the majority of them were pretty content living under the rule of the Ottoman Empire, being able to do their Jewish stuff, daven and study Torah and visit the graves of the righteous people, and they were okay with that. But in the beginning of the 20th century, the early years of the 20th century, everything changed. You have an influx of tens of thousands of young, idealistic Jews who want to go to Israel in order to found a new Jewish homeland in the land of Israel. And these Jews, for the most part, are not traditional. For the most part, they are not only secular, but a lot of them are socialists, which means that, if you know about socialism, socialism goes hand in hand with atheism. They're atheists. They don't want any part of religion. And they are not looking to enjoy, obviously, then, a life of spiritual fulfillment of prayer and Torah study and visiting the graves of the holy people. They want to build a homeland. They start kibbutzim, and they start towns. You know about the Ganya, you know about Tel Aviv, right? We've heard of these important milestones in the history of Israel. Those are founded in those years of what we call the Second Aliyah. And Rav Kook comes to Israel during that time as well. And Rav Kook became the rabbi, the chief rabbi of the city of Yafo, which today, you know, back then, Yafo was the city. Tel Aviv was some, you know, dunes on the sand. Now, we don't exactly think of it that way. But when Rav Kook became the rabbi of Yafo, he also became the rabbi of the surrounding areas, the agricultural settlements, the town. And Rav Kook comes in contact with all these young people. And again, he sees that they're young, and he sees that they're idealistic, and he sees that they openly say that we want no part in religion. We don't want any part of Shabbat, we don't want any part of holidays, we don't want any part of God, we don't want any part of Torah study. And they start doing things that really rankle people who came who were there as part of what we call the old Yishuv, the old settlement, those earlier Jews who have been there, all those religious ones. They're playing soccer in the park on Shabbat, and they're taking off the men, or taking off their shirts in public, and are exercising, and showing off their muscles, and all of these things that are really, really, you know, both aesthetically, viscerally, and halakhically opposed to Jewish values. And Rav Kook is in contact with these people. And for Rav Kook, unlike most of his colleagues, he doesn't see rebellion. And he doesn't see he doesn't see them as opposed to the values of Judaism and the Torah. But what Rav Kook sees is a group of people who very deeply want to do something Jewish, who very deeply want to build something, not just for themselves, but for the Jewish people generally. And Rav Kook, who is deeply steeped in Kabbalah, when he sees that, what he sees is people who are deeply connected, whether they know it or not, to God. They might not recognize it. If you ask them about it, they might laugh in your face. But what Rav Kook saw in his mystical understanding of the events that were taking place during his day are people who are building on behalf of the Jewish people generally, building something on behalf of the Jewish people generally that by definition, says Rav Kook, we'll see this in a second, is doing something spiritual, whether you understand it or not, and therefore, the building of the new Jewish homeland in Israel being done by these young socialists who seem to be atheists and are very publicly desecrating Shabbos in public is a holy task and is the realization for Rav Kook of our long-held aspirations to become a people in our country again. You know what we call that? What do you call it when we realize our long-held aspirations to be a people in our country again? Not Zionism. We call it Mashiach. Rav Kook sees it as messianic, redemptive. He sees the gevulah, the redemption, as literally knocking on the doors. I gave you a couple of excerpts. If you look at page 2, this is, I moved it to English now so we can at least pretend to understand what we're saying. Source number 2, Rav Kook says, and where I drew a nice crude little arrow there, the time is right, everlasting light, the true light of God, the light of the God of Israel, revealed by his wondrous people, must rise to the level of consciousness. This awareness must penetrate the inner being of our people so that it recognizes the ultimate oneness of his own potentialities and becomes aware of the God who dwells in it. In other words, Rav Kook says, there is something bubbling that's right beneath the surface, and we're waiting for it to come up, and it's the potential for all of these people who think that they're secular to understand that they're actually not secular, and all these people who think that they're building something which is not religious to actually realize that, no, you're doing something deeply, deeply religious, something that's going to bring godliness into the world. And if you skip to the next paragraph, I'll give you a little underline. Not only will this impact the Jewish people, but this, for Rav Kook, is going to have a global, universal impact. All of the civilizations of the world will be renewed by the renaissance of our spirit. All quarrels will be resolved, and our revival will cause all life to become luminous with the joy of fresh birth. All religions will don new and precious raiment, casting off whatever is soiled, abominable, and unclean. They will unite and imbibe in the dew of the holy light that were made ready for all of mankind at the beginning of time in the well of Israel. Rav Kook is essentially saying, in his very poetic and very mystical way, is that as the Jewish people are reborn in their land by creating this entity that they're trying to create, this Jewish homeland, that's going to have a ripple effect. And not only will the Jewish people be renewed in its land, but the renewal of the Jewish people will bring about the renewal of all of mankind, all of humanity. All religion, he says, will discover the core of truth. There is a core of truth in all religion, Rav Kook believes. And when the Jews are renewed in our land, the impact of our renewal will be for all people to be renewed, for all religion to uncover that core of truth and connect to the one true God, and goodness and light and holiness will be brought into the world. That is a Kabbalistic vision of Mashiach. You know the phrase Tikkun Olam? The phrase Tikkun Olam, which means fixing the world, is really, it derives from Lurianic Kabbalah, from the Kabbalah of the Ari, who lived in Tzfat. Many of you, I'm sure, visited some of the landmarks associated with it. The Ari was one who introduced into our vocabulary this idea that the world is a spiritually broken place, and that the job of Jewish people, by performing mitzvot and by understanding the Kabbalistic significance of our deeds, is to fix the world, the Takein Olam. Fixing the world, when the world is fixed, according to the thought of the Ari, that is when the world will be redeemed, and that is what he called Mashiach. And that's where Rav Kook is coming from. When the Jewish people are fixed, but not only spiritually, but physically fixed, when we are prepared as a people, and we're living in our own homeland, and we have our own state, we will bring about the fixedness of the rest of the world, and that will be the Messianic era. And that is what Rav Kook believes about what's happening in the land. Now, you will note that there's one phrase that I have not yet used when I talk about Rav Kook. That phrase is the state of Israel, the government, because Rav Kook is not yet living at a time where there is a state. They're at the beginnings of some organization. They're creating bureaucracy. Rav Kook himself was actually involved in the creation of some bureaucracy. But Rav Kook believed that the creation of bureaucracy is part of his holy messianic mission, because you're creating the infrastructure for Jews to be autonomous and to have sovereignty in their lands. So that's part of the advent of Mashiach as well. But there is still no state. You will know that Rav Kook died in 1935, which means that Rav Kook did not see the state of Israel. We'll get to that point in just a second. But look at page 3 for a second. Page 3 tells us that despite his idealism, Rav Kook is not naive. Despite his belief that the settlers, the Zionists, the pioneers who are building up the kibbutzim and the towns are people who secretly are holy people, even if they don't recognize it, he's not deceiving himself into thinking that everything is perfect at this point. You'll see the arrow. Despite the grave faults of which we are aware in our life in general, and in Eretz Israel in particular, we must feel that we are being reborn, and that we are being created once again as at the beginning of time. Rav Kook acknowledges that everything is not perfect. Rav Kook acknowledges that there's still a lot of work to do, that there are still both spiritual and material imperfections in Eretz Israel. They're not a state yet. The British, by the time he's writing this, 1920s, 1930s, the British are still in power, and the Jews are not yet fully religious, which for Rav Kook is an ultimate goal. Nevertheless, despite those grave faults, we have to feel that we're being reborn. And for Rav Kook, this is the name of the game. The name of the game is looking down the line. And a very firm belief that what's happening at his time in the early 20th century in Eretz Israel by secular people is going to have this ripple effect, that is going to have this spiritual impact on those people that will ultimately bring them back to religion when they realize the holiness of what they're doing. And then that will lead to the reparation of B'nai Israel, the tikkun of the Jewish people, and then ultimately the tikkun of all humanity. That piece, I should tell you that, unfortunately we don't have time for this. This would be a lecture or two in and of itself. But Rav Kook's attitude towards the pioneers, towards the Zionist settlers who are moving into Israel, it is really a really important component of his legacy. Rav Kook wrote a full essay about it, and over the years he wrote more and more religiously radical things until the final thing published, in which Rav Kook addresses the role of the Zionist pioneers, Rav Kook actually writes that the Zionists who are exercising in public because they want to have physical strength to work on behalf of the Jewish people are spiritually equivalent to Kabbalists who meditate on the divine name in private. Just to give you an idea of what happened when that was published, they brought the Gerer Rebbe, the base Israel, in from Poland in order to investigate Rav Kook's writings, because it had caused such a major trauma and such a controversy among Rav Kook's Haredi colleagues. And you have to remember that Rav Kook, all of his life, even though he identified with the Zionist movement in theory on many levels, he was personally Haredi. It caused such a controversy that they actually had to bring in people from Poland, rabbis from Poland, to investigate and to reach conclusions, and they concluded that Rav Kook is such a holy man that he doesn't quite understand what he's writing, and things like that. But I don't think the Kibbutz Shuvah existed back then. So that's Rav Kook writes. Just one more line I want to read you from the English on that same page, which is 431, the next column, where I want you to see this. The claim of our flesh is great. We require a healthy body. We have greatly occupied ourselves with the soul and have forsaken the holiness of the body. Rav Kook is saying, for the years of exile, Jews were so focused on spirituality, on learning Torah, doing mitzvot, that we haven't focused on our bodies, on the physical entity of the Jewish people. And what we're doing in Eretz Israel, says Rav Kook, is the creation of a healthy Jewish body. Now, having said that, it's pretty clear, I think, from what we've seen, that Rav Kook views the process, views
what's going on in Eretz Israel. Honey, you feel to Mrs. Kranzler. Cafeteria, the Earth Day Fair is going on. In the back of the cafeteria, the Earth Day Fair.
But, like I said before, the one issue in understanding Rav Kook, and it's very crucial to understand this, is the date when he's writing this. Because he's writing it, like I said, when the Yishuv is still young, when the pioneers are idealistic, when the Jewish people have not experienced the Holocaust yet, and when the Jewish people have not experienced the creation of the State of Israel yet. And so all of these ideas that Rav Kook is speaking about, really, 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 he's speaking about them in theory. Right? He's not really speaking about, he sees concrete things happening, but nothing has been seen through yet. Nothing has really, arrived at its destination. Yes, there are new cities, and there are new kibbutzim, and there are farms, and there is the beginnings of a government, and there is, in Rav Kook's own lifetime, a Balfour Declaration, but nothing has been finalized during Rav Kook's own lifetime. Everything still exists in theory. That is extremely important for the next passage we're going to read, which is still Rav Kook, the final passage that we're going to read from Rav Kook, but final, but extremely, extremely important for understanding the next step. What happens after Rav Kook, the elder? Rav Kook says this. This is also from Orot. I'm going to summarize for you a little bit in English. He says, usually being part of a state, being part of a government, is not the greatest thing that a human being could be. We have other ways of fulfilling ourselves, and governments tend not to live up to their responsibilities. You'll never find a government geopolitical entity that really is, you know, that really lives up to large spiritual ideals. So individuals can live up to large spiritual ideals. They could be spiritually fulfilled, but governments are not usually the best way to get there. But, says Rav Kook, there is one state, there is one government that might realize those spiritual ideals. And here's where I underline for you on page 4. I want you to listen to this line, because it's so crucial, and it's going to color a lot of the things that happen after Rav Kook. U'medinazu, this state, the state that does live up to its spiritual ideals. Hi medinatenu, this is our state. Medinat Yisrael, the state of Israel. Yesod kisei Hashem ba'olam, the foundation of God's throne in the world. Shekol cheftza hu sheyiyeh Hashem echad u'shmo echad. The entire desire of that state is that God should be one and God's name should be one. In other words, that godliness should be recognized in the world. Now, Rav Kook uses a phrase in this sentence. That's very important. What's the phrase? The phrase is Medinat Yisrael, right? Don't be deceived by that phrase, because the Zionists, the people who formed Medinat Israel, the actual state of Israel that we know today, did not decide to name it that until 1948. They already knew there was going to be a state before they figured out what the name was going to be. You know, Yehuda Avner wrote that big fat book about the prime ministers. So he writes that he was fighting in the trenches during the War of Independence, and they said, "You have your state." The state was founded, and you know what they asked? The first question they asked was, what's the name? It's great to have a state. What are we calling it? Because it wasn't clear. So Rav Kook uses the phrase Medinat Yisrael, but he doesn't mean the state of Israel, or does he? Here's where we begin with the controversies over the legacy of Rav Kook. Rav Kook says that our state, the state of Israel, is the foundation of God's throne in the world. In other words, godliness can be recognized in the world through the existence of the state of Israel. The only thing is that in Rav Kook's time, there was no state of Israel. So we have two ways of dealing with this. Either Rav Kook was, again, talking hypothetically, talking theoretically, addressing, sorry? He wasn't, well, okay, wait, we'll get that second. Talking about, you know, the hypothetical state of Israel, Israel meaning the Jewish people, the hypothetical state of Jewish people, that is the foundation of God's throne in the world. The alternative is that Rav Kook was a prophet. And he knew there was going to be a state of Israel, and he is stating in a concrete and incontrovertible way that the state of Israel, which parenthetically will not be founded until 13 years after I die, is the, I mean, you know, I'm sadly ironic, but not everybody takes it as irony, is the foundation of God's throne in the world. And this is where we begin to discuss the legacy of Rav Kook. Because the question is, when Rav Kook dies in 1935, and the Jewish people then go through the Shoah, and then shortly thereafter the state of Israel is founded, the question is, where does the legacy, the thought of Rav Kook, fit into this whole framework, into the historical events that have transpired? One person who thought he had a very clear answer to that question was Rav Kook's son, Rav Tzvi Yehuda Kook. Rav Tzvi Yehuda Kook was his father's right-hand man for years, and he took over the yeshiva, Merkaz Harav, after his father and Rav Kook's close associates died. And for Rav Tzvi Yehuda, everything that Rav Kook said, I'm going to say it a little bit, for Tzvi Yehuda, nothing that Rav Kook said was a hypothetical. Everything that Rav Kook said was to be taken as true and concrete and pertinent to the reality of his time. And Rav Tzvi Yehuda says these things after the Holocaust and after the State of Israel. Rav Tzvi Yehuda, after the State of Israel is founded, says everything that my father said is 100% true and applicable not only to his reality in 1904 and 1914 and 1921 and 1935, but to our very reality here and now, 1948, 1956, 1965, 1967. That's when Rav Tzvi Yehuda says, here's where the thoughts of Rav Kook are actually seen as true. Rav Kook spoke about the redemption that's going to happen. Rav Tzvi Yehuda says, now that we have a state, the redemption is absolutely happening. Incontrovertibly, no question about it. Right, I gave you on page 5. A little bit from some English sources on Rav Tzvi Yehuda. Rav Tzvi Yehuda didn't really publish anything, so what's published is generally his speeches, his conversations, and some of the public letters that he wrote. You know those posters up in the streets of Yerushalayim whenever they get angry at somebody about something? Rav Tzvi Yehuda was a master author of those. And he was, you'll see, always getting angry about something. Things that maybe he was writing angry about, but we'll see. About halfway down that first page, Rav Tzvi Yehuda taught that the Geula was occurring in our day. It's not potential, it's not that it could happen, it's not the first flowerings of our redemption, Reshit Tzvichat Geulateinu, it's not the Ikvitad Mashiach, the footsteps of the Messiah, none of that, said Rav Tzvi Yehuda. It's happening now. It's happening in the land of Israel. It was coming to fruition in the Jewish people's return to the land of Israel through the restoration of Jewish sovereignty over Eretz Israel and through a widespread return to Torah. All of these facets of Geula brought a clearer vision of Hashem's rule in the world. Right? This is clear. Again, I'm just going to skip a little bit. Go to the next page. If you look at the next page, also towards the middle of the page, just look at what's bold. Phenomenon like the religious pioneer, the non-religious pioneers and Israel's present form of statehood must be viewed in their true light, let's see who they taught, as important and divinely ordained step on the way to our true and ultimate Geula. It's happening now, we're in the midst of it, and here's where things get very, very important for Tzvi Yehuda. Because for Tzvi Yehuda, if we are in the midst of Geula, then there are a few important consequences here. There are a few very concrete things that come out of it. Number one, the status of the state of Israel. If we are really, really experiencing redemption, and if everything his father said was not only a theory from the early 20th century, but is a reality from the mid-20th century, Yehuda died in 1982, so from the mid to late 20th century, then what does that say about the state of Israel? What is it? It is a messianic, holy entity. Exactly. If you look on page 7, we have a section called The Sanctity of the State. First of all, look on page 7, look at the first side. You look at the bold, these are quotes from Rav Tzvi Yehuda. The intrinsic value of the state is not dependent on the number of observant Jews who live here. Of course, our aspiration is that all of our people will embrace the Torah. However, the state of Israel is kadosh, whatever religious level it has. The state itself is holy. If you turn to the to page 8, right, Rav Tzvi Yehuda says, there's the last paragraph on the left column. One must look at these matters in an encompassing perspective. The Lord's Torah is perfect, it restores the soul, Torah Hashem to Mima, Meshivat Nafesh. When the Torah is perfect and whole, then it restores the soul. We are dealing with a fundamental, all-encompassing matter, says Rav Tzvi Yehuda. Statehood. The statehood of Israel is totally kadosh, without any blemish at all. Woo! What does that mean? The state of Israel is totally holy. There's nothing wrong with Israel at all. And elsewhere, I don't even have enough space to give you all this. Rav Tzvi Yehuda will articulate it. He'll specify the government is holy, and the army is holy, and the people are holy, and the institutions are holy. So, consequence number one of believing that the state of Israel is not only potentially messianic, but actually messianic, is that it is holy. Now, I'll let you put it in parentheses for a second. If all those things are holy and without any blemish at all, well, what happens if they make a mistake? Well, the answer is they probably didn't make a mistake, right? The arch nemesis of Rav Tzvi Yehuda was a man by the name of Yeshayahu Leibovich, which some of you might have heard of. Leibovich cringed, and you can read in his writings the way that he cringed at the application of the term holy by Rav Tzvi Yehuda. And going back to the early 50s, 5 years into the state of Israel, Leibovich is already writing, if the army is holy and the state is holy, then what happens if the army acts in an unethical manner? What happens if the army doesn't really care about civilian casualties? It's holy, 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 holy. So you already see people in the early years critiquing Rav Tzvi Yehuda for these ideas, but nevertheless, because he accepts that his father's vision for the state of Israel was being actualized in his day, the state is holy. But there's another very important consequence. The other very important consequence is the boundaries of Eretz Israel. Because if we are concretely living through the Messianic era, then the boundaries of Israel have to reflect the actual halachic borders of Eretz Israel, according to Rav Tzvi Yehuda. Which means that Israel has to include everything. Yehuda, Shomron, Gaza. Rav Tzvi Yehuda is a maximalist. Eber HaYarden, the other side of Jordan, where the 2.5 tribes lived in the Torah. The Sinai, which Rav Tzvi Yehuda defined as part of Eretz Israel, which is not a universally accepted opinion. All of those things are part of Eretz Israel. In 1967, a couple of weeks before the Six-Day War broke out, Tzvi Yehuda gave a speech in Merkaz Harav in the yeshiva. And he said that in 1947, on the 29th of November, when they announced the partition plan, people were dancing in the streets. But I could not dance, said Tzvi Yehuda. I stayed home and I cried because they divided up Eretz Israel. We're going to have a Jewish state without Hebron. We're going to have a Jewish state without Shem. We're going to have a Jewish state without Yericho. But he keeps going. We're going to have a Jewish state without all those sections of Jordan that are, according to the Torah, part of Israel. Cry. Yeshavti badad ve'edom ki natal alai. That's what Tzvi Yehuda said in that speech. 2 weeks later, you know what happens? Six-Day War breaks out. By the conclusion of the Six-Day War, Hebron is in Israeli hands. Yericho is in Israeli hands. Gaza is in Israeli hands. We never quite made it to the other side of the Jordan River, but almost everything that Tzvi Yehuda said, I'm weeping for, suddenly are in Israeli hands. Now it's not only Rav Kook the Elder who's a prophet, right? Now Rav Tzvi Yehuda is a prophet as well. And his students are very much on board with Rav Tzvi Yehuda's prophecy. And a few years later, it's Rav Tzvi Yehuda's students who found Gush Emunim. Heard of Gush Emunim? Sorry?
The Gush area.
Exactly. Well, the Gush Emunim was the group that went out and founded not only the Gush area, right? That's Gush Etzion. The Gush Emunim, the people who founded the settlements at Kiryat Arba, the people who founded the settlements near Yericho, near Shechem, right? The people who go out and say, if this is part of the biblical land of Israel, we Jews need to be there. Now, that's the realization of the messianic vision of Israel. If Israel is concretely messianic right here and right now at this very time, then A, everything the state does is holy, and B, we have to get to the biblical borders of Israel, and C, we can never, ever give any of that land back to anybody. Right? That's consequence number three of Rav Tzvi Yehuda's thought. If you look on page 9. Page 9, I gave you two of Rav Tzvi Yehuda's big pronouncements about the state of, the settlements, about the territories. And both of these are in response to the undercurrent or the overt discourse in Israeli society that said, there's probably a good chance that we are not going to be here forever. Right? Most of the Israeli governments, and certainly the United Nations, and certainly Israel's allies, the United States, and so forth, are not exactly thrilled with Israel's presence in those lands. Well, Tzvi Yehuda releases these very, very strongly worded public pronouncements. And number one, I wanted to show you number one, because it's important, because it kind of juxtaposes all the big Tzvi Yehuda ideas together. I underlined a little bit of it for you. Sha'anachnu ka'et be'emunat itenu, we are, with our belief about our times, b'matzav ha'tahalich shel ketz ha'galut geula v'shiach. We are in the midst of the end of the exile, the redemption, the Mashiach. This is clear in the Torah. We have no clearer sign that Israel is being redeemed than the fact that the land is blossoming and so forth. So we are not, again, not in the beginnings of the Messianic era, but in the midst of the Messianic era. Number two, he says, there is a mitzvah for us to capture all of the land. Gimel, fighting a war against anybody who troubles us is considered a milchena mitzvah, commanded war. Number four, this land belongs to us and not to anybody else. We are not allowed to give up any piece of it. Not a single bit. And anybody who says otherwise, if you say we should give back any land in Israel, your ideas were less than the dust of the earth. Number five, if anybody forces us to try to give back any land, whether that person be Jewish or non-Jewish, we are going to resist. Now we start seeing something very interesting. Because we just said that Rav Tzvi Yehuda says the state is holy and the army is holy and the people are holy and the institutions are holy. But now he says if anybody tries to get us to retreat from any land, we're going to resist. Here you have the big paradox in the thought of Rav Tzvi Yehuda. Because, and again, you'll see the next step where we go with this. If the state is holy, then the government that's telling you to get out of the land is holy in carrying out God's mission. But at the same time, what do you do with the fact that you're not allowed to tell us to get out of any land? You're not allowed to tell us to retreat from any land. You have a paradox. Is it that everything the state does is holy? Or is it that the state is not allowed to tell us to do anything that involves compromising on the land of Israel? But not only could the state not tell us to do that. If you look at the next big announcement by Rav Tzvi Yehuda, I'll just read you the part that's underlined. Rav Tzvi Yehuda says, forget about it. There's not really that much to discuss. You know why? Because since we are in the midst of redemption, anybody who says that we're going to retreat from any of the lands, like any nonsense, it's never going to happen. It won't happen in the past. It won't happen in the future. Just forget about it, because it's nice enough to say we should get out of lands, but we know that it's never, ever going to happen. And that theme, you'll find throughout the writings of Rabbi Tzvi Yehuda, that it will never happen. You know why it will never happen? Because, and here's what's very important to understand. If we're in the midst of Geulah is progressive. History is progressive. History only moves in one direction. That direction is forward, exactly. We're moving forward with the divine plan to redeem the Jewish people. We're moving forward with the divine plan to bring Mashiach. So it will never happen that we're going to give back any land to the Arabs. What was the first time that Israel gave back big amounts of land to the Arabs? Sinai. Rabbi Tzvi Yehuda died 2 months before Israel withdrew from the Sinai. Whew. His students, of course, said that he just couldn't bear spiritually to live long enough to see that terrible event take place. But let's just jump ahead a few years now. Let's go to 2005. Because when Israel was going to withdraw from Gaza in 2005, the spirit of Rabbi Tzvi Yehuda reigned over many of the religious Zionist rabbis at that time as well. On page 10, you have a letter from Rabbi Mordechai Eliyahu to the Gaza settlers before withdrawal. It says, to our brothers, the settlers in Yesha, powerful heroes and performers of his will, who are working at settling the expanses of our ancestral homeland in Gush Katif, may your well-being forever prosper. In this missile, in this letter, I wish to strengthen your hands against the terrible moral evil of the intention to evict settlements and expel Jews from their homes. It shall not happen. That's where Mordechai Eliyahu. Mordechai Eliyahu was the Sephardic chief rabbi throughout the 80s, and he became one of the leading rabbis of the religious Zionist community. The seer of generations in advance who answered our father Abraham about Moriah will answer us and bring our justice into the light. No one shall stop the divine process of the national revival of the Jewish people of Israel that is returning to its land. This is from Rabbi Tzvi Yehuda. Now you would think somebody who lived through the evacuation of Sinai in the 1980s might have been a little bit more careful with their words, but nevertheless, Rabbi Mordechai Eliyahu, again, a luminary, I can't use any other word to describe him, puts it all out there and says, it's not going to happen. Just forget about it, because it's not real. We all know that it happened.
Did he really mean it's not going to happen?
There are a lot of rabbis who taught that it's not going to happen. Absolutely, there is no way that this is going to happen. And that's why it led to a major theological crisis amongst the people who lived there.
It should happen.
I don't want to talk about whether it shouldn't happen. Yeah, I want to talk about just, so we could definitely, we could argue about that from today till tomorrow, but what concerns me more is what happens when the rabbis tell their students that it will not happen and then it ultimately happens. It's a little bit problematic.
Especially when the state is perfect.
So here's where we get to our big dilemma. The state is perfect, right? The state is absolutely perfect with no blemish whatsoever. But now the state is telling you to get out of your land. You know what happens now? I don't even want to put it out there. That paradox in the thought of Rabbi Tzvi Yehuda leads to a break. Now, beginning in 2005 and continuing to this very day, we now have two different schools of thought. How do we interpret Rabbi Tzvi Yehuda? You have one school of thought that emphasizes what they call mamlachtiyut, which means loyalty to the government. The government is good, and the government is holy, and we have to listen to the government. And even if we don't like what the government teaches or rules and or commands, we still have to be loyal to the government. Those are rabbis who you might have heard of. Rav Aviner from Beit El is an example of one of those rabbis who said that soldiers should obey orders whether you like it or not. The leading rabbi of that school is a rabbi named Rav Tau, Rav Tzvi Tau, who is the head of a yeshiva called Har Hamor and is the spiritual mentor for a lot of people. He's a student of Rav Tzvi Yehuda, and he says also, we need to conquer the state spiritually and emotionally and not just refuse to keep any orders. I'm going to just show you one thing. If you skip to page 16, I gave you an excerpt from Rabbi Yuval Sherlo, who's one of the great public intellectuals in the religious Zionists in Israel today. And he says, Mamlachti l'chatchila, 2006. I am a Mamlachti, I listen to the state, and I consider it ideal. What makes me into a Mamlachti l'chatchila? So if you look at the third paragraph, he says, Mamlachti l'chatchila mashma'o, the meaning of being a Mamlachti is to believe that Israel is Reshit Smichat Gula v'Yeshua. Israel is the redemption, no matter what. The very existence of Israel is redemptive. More. Next paragraph. Mamachti l'chatzila huzeh ha-metabelet ha-drachim bahen ha-metinach Israel mitnahelet. Somebody who's a mamachti accepts the direction that the state of Israel is going, the decisions of the Knesset and the government, even if you do not like them, you accept them. The last paragraph on page 16. Mamachti l'chatzila eino sho'et l'hitnatik mitnach Israel. Mamachti l'chatzila does not want to separate from the state of Israel, ulahakim alternativa, to create some alternative, b'medinat Yehuda, b'medinat Yerushalayim, so let's just move into Judea, we'll have our own state there, forget about Israel, because Israel is corrupt. In other words, one school of thought, and you get from this passage of Rav Shurlo, both schools of thought, after the evacuation from Gaza, some people say, you know what, this state is finished, this state is clearly not the realization of Rav Kook's ideas. This state is clearly not Yisod Kisei Hashem Ba'olam, the foundation of God's throne in the world, because it violates the Torah. So when they have to choose which side of Tzvi Yehuda they're going to choose, the side that says the state is holy, or the side that says we could never, ever, ever compromise any inch of land, they chose, one side chose option two, the other side chose option one, and now, to this day, there was an op-ed about this in Haaretz maybe 4 months ago, talking about the legacy of Tzvi Yehuda, is two groups of rabbis, one who say, always obey the state, even if you don't like it. The other says, if the state is violating the Torah, we are not beholden, and we are not obligated to listen to the state in any way. All of these crises are all rooted in the idea that history is moving in one direction, and that it can never really, really move back. I have a sense that we're running low on time, so I want to run on time. Okay, so I want to just wrap it up with the American version of Zionism, and it's Rav Soloveitchik. Rav Soloveitchik, and we'll do it quickly. Rav Soloveitchik, we won't read that much in time. Rav Soloveitchik formulated what he called a halachic approach to this. Essentially, a halachic approach looks at history, it looks at current events, it looks at the things that are happening to you in the world, and instead of saying, why did these happen? And what does God want? It asks, basically, what is my obligation? How am I meant to react to these events? How am I meant to act, given that I've experienced what it is that I have experienced? And that, he said, 1956, should be our reaction to the state of Israel. I'll just tell you that Rav Soloveitchik, when he did this, was breaking very strongly with the Soloveitchik family tradition, which was strongly anti-Zionist. We have in the library here a book about the Rav's uncle, the Brisker Rav, who was probably as great as his nephew, let's just say that. When he was a rabbi of Brisk, the Zionists of Brisk wanted to hold a memorial for Herzl, and he personally locked them out of the shul. That's what it says in the book that we have here in the library. So, I don't know if it's true, if it's not true, but it certainly reflects the way people thought about the Soloveitchiks. And the Rav broke with that. And he said, you know what? The circumstances, the momentous tumult through which we're living, the Holocaust and the establishment of Israel requires us to respond. God is calling upon us, and we have to respond. And for him, the response was joining up with the Zionist movement. He spoke about the six knocks. I gave you the whole excerpt here in your packet. We don't need to read through it right now. It's a very famous thing. It's very much worthwhile reading through. What's interesting about the six knocks that the Rav articulated is that all of those six knocks are knocks that were relevant in the 1940s, in the 1950s, some of them in the 1960s, but I don't know how many of them still pertain in 2012. Put that out there. Whether it's about the UN, or about assimilation, or about the Israeli... Some of them, yes. I don't know if all of them do continue to pertain today. But what's interesting about the thought of Rav Soloveitchik, in contrast to the thought of the Cook family and their legacy, is that if you don't see yourself as part of a linear process, a progressive, forward-moving process, the Geula, we are going there, and nothing can ever deter us from going there. Instead, Rav Soloveitchik is more of a response to current events. If you're more responsive, if you're more reactionary, if you will, then you're never bound by, you know, let's say you don't get into the same crisis as somebody who believes that history is only going in one direction and can never be taken back. You allow yourself to respond to the circumstances of your day. And if the circumstances of your day is a war in 1967 that in which Israel gains a lot of very emotionally relevant and historically and halachically relevant territory, then you respond accordingly. And if what you see going on a few decades later is the government of Israel making decisions that might compromise that territory, then there is an appropriate response for that as well. But it doesn't cause theological crisis. None of the negotiations and the concessions and whatever we think about them pro or con necessarily causes a crisis if you accept the Soloveitchik school of thought, which says God sends messages to us through history. God sends messages to us through momentous occasions that occur in the world, and our responsibility is to know the appropriate response and reaction to the messages that we're receiving from God. These are two big models, probably, you know, for us in American modern orthodoxy, the two prevalent models of Zionism. The Rav Kook school that speaks of Israel as messianic and redemptive and as going in one direction. And I can't tell you now, if we have time, the intense creativity and the real flourishing of Jewish life that that school has bred, but that also could lead to a lot of theological crisis. And the Rav Soloveitchik school that on one hand seems to be more bound to the practical and the current events of the day, that seems to be more reactionary rather than proactive, but on the other hand allows us to create a Zionist theology that responds, that is dynamic, that flows with the circumstances of the time, and that maintains its relevance no matter what those circumstances are. Two big schools of thought, something to think about as you go into Yom HaTzmaut this coming week. Thank you all very much for listening and for sticking with me.
Next year, and I hope to see you all, and there'll also be a couple of other results.